Tonight, we take you along on a desperate effort to find a kidnapped little girl with exclusive interviews and never-before-seen video. We should tell you, the mother gave us permission to share her daughter's story and the video. Some of it may be hard to watch. Here's Carol Evans' Lou Ragoose with A Race Against Time. A developing story tonight in Bemidji.
3:30 a.m., June 22nd, 2016. A fire.
Bruce, could you shine the light on that gas can again?
An arson fire brings Bemidji investigators to the Hillcrest Manor Mobile Home Park, and they quickly find a victim.
I was told that we had a fire scene with a victim that was bound with tape.
Special Agent Paul Girardi with the BCA takes the lead on the case. The victim is Melissa Norby, a 35-year-old single woman who lives in the trailer. Officers begin searching for suspects, searching for motive, when at noon, more than 8 hours after the fire, the case takes a turn.
There was a parent at the barricades stating that their child had spent the night at this home. She collapsed in front of me onto the ground.
I know that the mother was just plain frantic, and for us it was an emotional roller coaster.
I have a child the same age as this little girl, and it was like, what would I expect the person I'm telling this to do for me?
Norby was babysitting the 5-year-old girl that night. So investigators search again.
Checked every cupboard, any possible place a kid could have went.
We searched and sifted and dug and removed layer after layer and did not find any other remains.
There's absolutely no one else there.
Confident no one else died in the fire, investigators now know whoever killed Melissa Norby likely kidnapped the little girl. And they know they're running out of time to find her alive.
Everyone's going a million miles an hour in 800 different directions because we have a missing 5-year-old that we need to find right now.
We started tracking down past boyfriends, past people that she had been in relationships with right away.
Melissa Norby has seen a guy by the name of Jake, has blue eyes, has a food truck.
They trace the food truck to Jacob Kinn. Jacob Kinn, a 32-year-old with child porn convictions.
All of us in the room immediately went, oh my God, he's our guy.
They reach him by phone, and Kinn agrees to be questioned and arrives by midnight.
I appreciate you coming in.
Girardi and Senior Special Agent Chad Musaeus sit down with Kinn.
You recognize this little girl? I already answered that question.
He was completely deceptive. He was lying to us. He was very defensive in his question, in his answers.
I didn't do anything to the little girl. I haven't seen the little girl. I haven't seen Melissa in a long time. I haven't done anything.
Kinn doesn't realize they traced his location during their earlier call.
Your cell phone is not even close to where you say you're fishing. That's concerning to us.
I don't know how that would have happened, but yeah, I wasn't in Big Ford. I had no reason to be in Big Ford.
There's a difference of about 30 or 35 miles.
Special Agents Don Newhouse and Rob Frake discover Kinn's family owns land near Big Fork. They head in that direction. But Girardi and Musaeus notice Kinn's boots and pants are wet. Grass hangs from his vehicle outside. They don't have enough evidence to arrest him yet. And now, 24 hours after the fire, hope seems to flicker out.
At that point, we figured for sure, being that he had left her, that there probably wasn't a good chance of her being alive.
I think we all know the statistics.
Yeah.
And we know that finding a child alive in that time period is not, it's a slim to none.
I told our team, go home. We need to get some sleep. Tomorrow's gonna be a long day. What that meant was we were going to be recovering as opposed to rescuing this 5-year-old.
Are you a father yourself?
Yes.
Are cases like that different?
They're different, yeah. It's when you have kids of your own, you realize how precious they are. And, yep. Sorry. I lost a sister to a homicide, so. And having kids, you can't imagine what the family was going through and being there.
As most of the investigators rest, Frake and Newhouse find a remote road in Itasca County with fresh tracks. With the sun rising, it leads them to this hayfield, which leads them to this camper, tucked behind a grove of trees, the door taped shut.
It was wrapped up tightly in a way that they're holding somebody captive inside.
Is it okay if I come in? Okay, you don't have to be scared, okay? We're the police.
And the door opened up and little girl is alive.
They walk in, filming, to document evidence, making sure she's okay.
My name's Rob and this is Don. How old are you?
Probably five or something.
Okay. Where are you taped at? Okay, anywhere else?
Okay, we'll call your mommy pretty soon here.
They pull her out to bring her home. First, snapping this photo.
And he sends me a picture of her with Rob, and she's smiling, and she's healthy, and she's alive.
I cried.
I just remember thinking, no way, there's no way she's alive.
All right, Jake, you're under arrest.
And after arresting Ken, this photo they use.
What changed between 2 hours ago and now?
To show Ken, they've got him.
That's kind of a gotcha moment.
Yeah.
Jacob Ken would be convicted of kidnapping, rape, and murder, sentenced to 52 years in prison.
A soulless, remorseless human being.
After sorting through countless text messages, investigators would learn Ken had help.
It was like a slap in the face. It was unbelievable. This whole thing was laid out, planned out, staged out from the beginning.
Melissa Norby, the babysitter and supposed friend of the little girl's family, helped Ken plot the abduction before Ken killed her.
It was unbelievable.
But to these men and women who too often have to deliver bad news, bringing the little girl safely home to her parents reminds them why they do what they do.
Oh, to have a child that is the same age as her, and it was just amazing to know the statistics and know that we got her back alive.
It made my career to be a part of this. To be a part of this case was, if my career ended tomorrow, I'd be happy.
The law enforcement officials involved in this case received a prestigious Heroes Award in Washington, D.C. from the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. And I talked with the little girl's mom, and she wanted us to say that we are very, very thankful that they brought our baby girl home safe and sound.
Yeah, and it's amazing. You said they also say she's doing well.
Little girl's doing well. The police have checked in on her. They, you know, kind of have an arm around her in the community, and they say it's so great to see her thriving in their community in Bemidji.
We oftentimes don't think of these law enforcement people as human beings.
Yeah.
Sometimes,
you know, a lot
have emotions when they go and, you know, investigate these cases.
Most of them were parents. A lot of them had kids the same age. It really, you know, sticks out.
Very compelling story.
Thanks.
Thank you, Lou.